Hi everyone, I hope you're all keeping well. There we go. Fantastic. So welcome to another live ukulele jam with me, Matt Stead. I hope you're all having a brilliant week and you've been enjoying or you're about to enjoy the solar eclipse if it's happening where you are. I don't even know what time it's happening. Over where we are, there's a tiny bit of the UK where you'll see it, but mostly you won't see it over here. So I'm not quite up to date with it and what's happening with all that. As with always, there's a little bit of delay and buffering at the start whilst we get going. So what I'll do is I'll just play you a little bit of a song, just something daft instrumentally, and then we'll get going after that. And I'll tell you about everything that's happening today. Here we go. A little bit of blues for you. So the reason I played that one just out of interest was this week I've started recording a new series for the website and it will look something like this. So we're going to do a series of jazz and blues songs. And I thought what I'll do to start off with, I'll take you right back to one of the earliest jazz songs. And we're going to have a look at Dr. Jazz, which was actually originally written by King Oliver and played by his band. But it was kind of made famous by Jelly Roll Morton. So we're going to have a load of fun learning that with the words and everything. Hello Central, give me Dr. Jazz. It's a really, really cool kind of, as I say in the video, it's like a blend of the kind of energy of ragtime, but with the informality of the blues, which is really good fun. So hopefully you'll enjoy that one. So I thought I'd just do that to warm us up. It's my last week, hopefully, before I get my fast broadband in. So just remember, we're away next week. I'm having my broadband installed. So fingers crossed, we won't have any buffering after next week and we'll be into the fast stuff. I know I've said that before and they didn't turn up, but they have promised me this time. So we should be good to go. Let's see how everyone's doing. Let's see how we are. Oh, cool. Is it kind of happening now then? We had a brilliant total eclipse in the UK about 20 years ago, I guess. It was really special. I went to the top of a hill where I lived and we kind of live in the middle of nowhere. And there were loads of druids at the top in their capes and everything. It was really quite eerie, but it was good fun. So yeah, cool. Oh, and Indrani's got half of the Sahara on her car. Oh no. Thanks Indrani, it's the new kamaka I got. Yeah, I love it. I'm absolutely loving it. Nice traditional Hawaiian ukulele. So what we're going to do is we're going to do songs from Pet Sounds today, an absolute classic album. Everyone seemed to really enjoy the Tapestry Week that we did a few weeks ago, where we looked at the songs of Carole King. And we looked at songs specifically from that album. What we're going to do is we're going to do a similar thing tonight where we're going to do three songs from the classic album Pet Sounds by the Beach Boys, which is an absolutely beautiful album. Everyone thinks of the Beach Boys as kind of like cars and girls and surfing, but Pet Sounds is a really sophisticated album with some beautiful, beautiful chords. And tonight is no exception. We've got some really gorgeous songs with some really quite unusual, sophisticated chords. But of course, I'll help you out with it. I'll make it easy for you. So we'll go into a lot of details. And I'm really excited about it. I need cheering up today, guys. We're all friends. So I can share with you. I've had one of those days where it's like everything's gone wrong. So woke up this morning and Sharon had put her back out so she can hardly move. And then our car broke down. The battery's gone, so we had to get a new car battery. And then when I got into work, I managed to smash my coffee pot. So I've not even been able to have a coffee all day. And then, to make matters worse, the people upstairs, they've gone now, were doing renovations. So all day when I was trying to record videos, every time I got into the middle of a song, it'd be bang, 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 hammer, hammer, hammer. So I've had an absolutely terrible day. But tomorrow's my birthday, and hopefully I'm going to take the day off and it'll be marvellous, and I've got all the bad luck out of the way. But just in case you're wondering why I look so frazzled, that's what's going on. I've had a bad day, but it can only get better. I'm with you guys for Kanikapila. That's my favourite part of the week, so we'll be good. It'll only get better from here on in. As always, if you've got any questions today, just let me know and ping them along as we go along, and I will do my best to help answer them. So, oh, cool. Yeah, 1999, that was it. Yeah, I went up Breedon Hill in Gloucestershire, just up the road from here. So, oh, that was really good, wasn't it? Apparently down by the lizards and around Cornwall was a really good place to see the eclipse, wasn't it? Fantastic. So let's have a look at our first song, and I'll kind of dig into what's happening with Kanikapila, how it all works. Tonight is going to be slightly different because these chords are quite sophisticated. I'm going to concentrate on the chords rather than talking too much about the progressions in terms of the Nashville numbers. But as a basics, you guys know this already, we take our key, such as this one's in the key of F, and we give all of our chords numbers, 1 through to 7, F, G, A, B flat in the key of F, C, D and E. So we number them 1 through to 7. And if a Nashville number is uppercase, that's going to be a major chord. If it's lowercase, it's going to be a minor. And generally the 2, 3 and the 6 are minors, 1, 4, 5 major, and the 7 is some form of diminished chord. So this kind of way of doing it with the chord charts allows you to see these progressions really, really nicely. Now, don't be scared when you see some of these names like D, what looks like D triangle 7, that's a D major 7. Sounds scary, but actually when we come to play it, it's not that bad at all. I'll talk you through each one in turn. So this one was the opening song of Pet Sounds, and it creates a really nice upbeat kind of feel. But if you look at the lyrics, if I just move my sheet so I can see them, wouldn't it be nice if we're older, then we wouldn't have to wait so long? Wouldn't it be nice to live together in the kind of world where we belong? Really positive. Oh, thanks, Sheila. Thank you. So it's kind of positive, but also there's a touch of melancholy, right? And you really feel it in the next bit. You know it's going to make it that much better when we can say good night and stay together. So it's kind of teen angst, right? But it's really, really kind of beautifully written. The words were written by Tony Asher, incidentally. So Brian Wilson, the leader of the Beach Boys at this point, he quit touring and he wrote all these songs at home. And he always worked with a lyricist. Sometimes he wrote lyrics, but generally worked with a lyricist. And in the past, it'd been like people like Gary Usher or Mike Love, his cousin and fellow Beach Boy. And in this case, he used Tony Asher. And they're really, really beautiful words. So let's have a look at from the off at what's happening in this song then. So the start of the song is relatively straightforward. We're in the key of F, so we have the home chord, as you'd imagine, sets us off on our journey. We're not going to do the intro today because the chords are so beautiful and we've got so much to cover. We're not going to do all the kind of tapped bits like the do 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 do. Always makes me think Jim will fix it. We don't mention that program anymore. But we're going to go straight into the chords. So one F major being our one chord. Then we go to the four chord. And in any key, the four chord tends to give a sense of change, but nothing too drastic. Really common thing to happen in folk and pop music. And in this case, our four chord, because we're in the key of F, is B flat. Quite a tricky one. Now, generally, I would get you to do a barred B flat like this, because you can change it into a B7 by moving this finger, a B minor by moving this finger. But if you can, try doing your three finger B flat with this finger just covering the E and the A strings, okay? You'll see why in just a second. Try and keep that wrist as straight as possible. That's going to really help you with this B flat chord. If it's like this, notice it's really difficult for me then to get this finger to come down because the wrist is kind of forcing those fingers up. So pull back your arm in towards your body and try and get that wrist as straight as possible. Also noticed that we're coming at an angle. We're going across this way. So instead of all your fingers being straight up like that, notice that they're angled. That allows me to reach across to these notes really nicely like this. Okay. Fantastic. So that's going to be our B flat chord. Indran is just asking, is anyone else's feed frozen? Just leave us a comment if there's any problems. It could just be the normal buffering at the start. If you refresh, just let us know. But if there are any problems, let me know and I'll see if I can restart the feed or something. Fingers crossed will be okay. Okay. Now, the reason we do that B flat is the next two chords are really beautiful. We have a G minor 7 where we take away this finger and we just have the rest of that B flat chord down basically, and having this open G turns it into a G minor 7. And then gradually we just drop down to the C 7. That's a lovely 2-5 progression. Now, in jazz music, these 2-5s are often followed with a 1. 2-5-1. They're really key building blocks in jazz music, and you're going to see them come up all the time tonight, these lovely 2-5-1s. So in terms of the progression, we strum F, 1-2-3-4. 1-2-3-4, B flat for 4, 1-2-3-4, 1-2-1-2. Isn't that lovely? So each one of those boxes just 4 strums. Let's try it together. 1-2-3-4, F, 2-3-4, 1-2-3-4, B flat, G minor 7, C7, we go again. You got it. Fantastic. Let us know how you got on with that, folks. Next section is really lovely. We go to the sixth chord. And the sixth chord in any key is about creating a really nice kind of sense of melancholy. Oh, Adrani, I think it might be your internet connection. It seems to be fine where Stefan is. So thanks, Stefan, for letting me know. So when we go to the sixth chord, it creates like this really lovely sense of melancholy. And we play that as a D minor 7. Just think of it as like a D minor chord with this little finger added here. Now, if you struggle with that one, it's absolutely fine to play just a normal D minor. But that D minor 7 adds a really nice transition because the next chord, C minor 7, we still have the C in it. Okay. So we go from D minor 7 here. You know it's gonna make it that much better. Then we go back to D minor 7. When we can say goodnight. Then A minor 7, the three chords. So we're getting all the minor chords from the key. That's just no fingers at all, A minor 7. So that creates a really nice melancholy. I'll play that really slowly. D minor 7. C minor 7. Minor 7, fingers off, A minor 7. Then we've got that 2-5-1 that we had up here, only this time we've got a whole measure of G minor 7, whole measure of C7, and then we pause there. All right. Now that C minor 7, if you find it useful, you can double up that bar to give it a bit more pressure. You'll notice I'll sometimes double up like that to allow me to push down harder, which can be really useful. Another way you can do it is with all four fingers in a row like this, if you can squeeze them in as well. That way you can keep your little finger down, look, and just switch over like that. Have a bit of an experiment and see what works best for you. Let's just try one of those choruses really slowly. 1-2-3-4. You know it's gonna make it that much better. when we can stay goodnight and stay together. All right, yeah, cool. Sorry, I got lost a bit of the vocals at the end there, but I'll get it right when we get there. Okay, now notice that this section here is blanked out, this kind of grey section. That just means the first chorus, as soon as you hit that G minor 7, C7, stay together, we go back to another verse. Wouldn't it be nice when we were older? All right, so we go to another verse. The second time we play the chorus, we hit this F at the end of it. So that will sound something like this. No one's gonna make it. Oh, let me sing the right one. Where are we? But happy times together we'd be spending. I wish that every kiss was never ending. Oh, wouldn't it be nice? Ba-da-da-ba-da-da-ba-da. So we go back to that F, which is really lovely. All right, yeah, cool. Let's try, because there's quite a lot with all this going on tonight. Let's try a verse and a chorus, see if we can do it. Let's give it a go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Wouldn't it be nice if we were older and we wouldn't have to wait so long? And wouldn't it be nice to live together in the kind of world where we belong? You know it's gonna make it that much better when we can say goodnight and stay together. Let me do another verse. Wouldn't it be nice if we could wake up in the morning when the day is new, after having spent the day together, hold each other tight the whole night through? Another chorus. But happy days together we'd be spending. I wish that every kiss was never ending. And then F. Oh, wouldn't it be nice? Ba ba da da. See how we stay on that F the next time through, which is really nice. Now, this is why I think Brian Wilson was a bit of a genius, and I get angry when people say, oh, it's just surfing music, right? Because actually, he did some really sophisticated things, and this next section is really unusual. So, hi Karen. Normally, when we go to a new section, we use the change chord, the 4 chord, F, G, A. That's B flat in this key. Or we use the relative minor, which is the 6 chord, F, G, A, B flat, C, D. And that would be played as a D minor. Now, it's really interesting. Brian Wilson goes to the 6 chord, but instead of playing it as a minor, a D minor, which you would normally get in the key of F, we've got a D major 7, which gives it a really beautiful, wistful sound. So really unusual chord here. Now, to play that D major 7, if you ever see a triangle, by the way, in jazz, it just means major. It's another way of saying D major 7. All right. We bar the whole of that second fret. And then we use our ring finger, or you can use your little if you prefer, on the 4th fret of the A string. It's that beautiful sounding chord. Maybe if, okay, that's the start. Maybe if. Then we just drop this finger down for this G major 7 here. We'll think and wish and hope and pray. Then we go to the 3 chord, F sharp minor. That just looks like a G7 moved up towards your nose. Might come true. And then a B minor 7, just flatten the whole of that second fret. And then we do it again. Keep your finger there. Baby then, drop down. There wouldn't be a single thing. F sharp minor, we wouldn't do. Second fret. And then we basically just go between those chords again. Another F sharp minor, we could be married. B minor 7. then we'd be happy. C7. Now that's really arresting, isn't it, that chord? And that's really cool because it takes you out of the key of D and back into F again, because C7 is 5 above F. The 5 chord, F, G, A, B flat, C, it really wants to resolve to the C chord. So that takes you back to the key of F, okay? And notice we also slow down there. We've never done this before in Kanikapila. This song actually slows down completely into the outro. All right, I'll show you what I mean. I'll play you that bridge and we'll have a go. This one's quite hard for me to sing, so I'll just try my best. This one goes really high here. Here we go. I'll slow it down as well. 1, 2, 3, 4. Maybe here we think and wish and hope and pray it might come true. Baby, then there wouldn't be a single thing we couldn't do. We could be married, then we'd be happy. Then we slow down. Slow right down. That's because when we go to this outro, which is basically, it's really the outro again, you might think, oh no, loads more chords. It's basically this bit again with a little tweak, all right? And when we go to it, we've slowed down so much that we're just going to strum each chord once like this. You know that it seems the more we talk about it, it only makes it worse to without it, but let's talk about it. And then when we hit the C7, we bring the tempo back up and start strumming. Wouldn't it be nice? Ba-da-da, ba-da-da, ba-da-da. And we sing the outro, which is just our goodnight, my baby bit. Okay, let's try this bridge really slowly into this section with the slowing up and speeding down, and then we'll stick the whole thing together and have loads of fun. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Maybe if we think and wish and hope and pray it might come true. Baby, then there wouldn't be a single thing we couldn't do. Seems the more we talk about it, it only makes it worse to live without it. But let's talk about it. Wouldn't it be nice? Ba ba da da ba da da ba da da. Good night, my baby. You got it to the end, basically. Oh, such a gorgeous song, this one. And yeah, so pretty. Excuse me. Those chords are so sophisticated sounding, aren't they? Just beautiful. And all they are, we've just got normal three-part chords, like G minor, and they've just added an extra part, so turning them into four-part chords by, say, adding that seventh, turning it into a G minor seven. But it's his choice of chords, going between that verse in F and then that bridge in D. People didn't do this. It's almost like going back to classical music. Even jazz musicians didn't really do this. So just brilliant. All right. Okay, let's give it a go. This could go horribly wrong. Hopefully not, but we'll give it a go. I'll stay on close camera. I'll come in really close so you can follow my fingers. All right. And we'll give it a bash and then I'll see how you got on at the end. Here we go. Well, let's just do the verse just as an intro, and then we'll do it as verse one. 1, 2, 3, 4. B flat, G minor 7, and again, then we're going to do it one more time with the vocals. Wouldn't it be nice if we were older? Then we wouldn't have to wait so long. Wouldn't it be nice to live together in the kind of world where we belong? You know we're gonna make it that much better when we can say goodnight and stay together. Wouldn't it be nice if we could wake up in the morning when the day is new? After having spent the day together, hold each other tight the whole night through. But happy times together we've been spending, I wish that every kiss was never ending. Now F, wouldn't it be nice? Ba-da-da, 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 ba-ba-da-da, ba-da-da, ba-da. If we think and wish and hope and pray it might come true, baby, then there wouldn't be a single thing we couldn't do. We could be married, then we'd be happy. Oh, wouldn't it be? Outro. You know, it seems the more we talk about it, it only makes it worse to live without it. But let's talk about it. Wouldn't it be nice? Ba-da-da. Well done, everyone. That's a toughie. That's the hardest one tonight. So if you got through that, you'll be fine. It's going to get easier from here on in. Don't worry. Quite tricky because that was quite a high tempo. So, question from Mike. Is G major 7 different to G7? Yeah, absolutely. So it's all about the seventh note. So when we play a normal G major 7, the notes that make up a G major chord are G, A, and B. And we call that the first, the third, and the fifth of a chord, or a major triad, 1, 3, and 5, G, B, D. I told you my brain would have gone kaput today. So G, B, and D is the major triad in G, because we don't play A, and we don't play C, G, A, B. Okay, a G, B, D. Sorry. G, B, D. Right. Now, the seventh note, we in a major chord, we play by skipping. So we go G, B, D, not E. We play an F. But in the key of G, that F should be an F sharp. In every key, there's a certain amount of sharps or flats. And in the key of G, there's one sharp and it's the F sharp. So it should be an F sharp. And that's what we get when we play a normal G major 7. We're adding this note here, look, this is your F sharp. So normal G major is just G here, B here, D here, and we've got another G here. And when we turn it into a major 7, in effect, it's almost like we're moving this finger back. We're adding this F sharp. A G7, otherwise known as a dominant 7, that F sharp becomes an F, a normal F. Okay, so it has a kind of a more unresolved bluesy quality. So G major 7 has the F sharp, and G7 has the F. In fact, sometimes they're played together. You might recognise this. It's the Start of Something by George Harrison. He likes to use those three chords together, which is really, really, really lovely. So there you go. Stefan's got it right as well. Well done, Stefan. So Karen, F to B flat sometimes hurts your arthritic knuckle if you don't place your finger in the right spot. So yeah. Hi, Karen, by the way. I haven't even said hello yet. I hope you're doing well. So physio is helping finger mobility. Oh, that's amazing. It's really good to practice kind of finger mobility and warming up. Something I don't talk a lot about in Kanikapila because we race right into it. But before you start playing, always stretch your hands. I like to do that evil megalomaniac. If you really stretch those hands out, you can physically see, look, can you see the blood in my hands? You can actually see they've gone red. By really pushing, you get that blood flowing through your fingers, which is really important and warms them up. You can also do some really simple exercises just by playing along the fret, making sure you get as close to the metal fret as possible. That can be really good, just to kind of warm up. And you can do it in reverse, is good. So yeah, practicing your warm up as well. But the F to B flat, key for me is keeping that arm as straight as possible. So many people do this, but we really want it as flat as possible like that. That should help as well. So yeah, cool. Keep that wrist flat, Indrani. It could be a bent wrist that can do that as well. So yeah, it was quite a tricky one, wasn't it, Rebecca? Absolutely, it was quite tough. Oh, Barbara, enjoy the eclipse. It must be happening now then, guys. That's really good. That's really cool. Okay, let me just see if there's any new comments, because there's quite a lot came in there. Let's just whiz down. Oh, it seems to have frozen up a second. Go on, computer, you got this. There was all those crazy rumours, wasn't it, about the eclipse driving things mad. But I think I'm not superstitious at all. But maybe that's why I've had one of these kind of glitchy days. My computer's glitching now. Hopefully you can still hear me. It just seems to, I can't move the comments down. But hopefully you can. Ah, there we go. It's just being slow. Cool. Oh, I'm there. Cool. Oh, nicely done. Nicely done. Fantastic. Yeah, cool. Fabulous. All right then, guys, let's have a look at another really, really beautiful song from Pet Sounds. I'll bring the sheets back up and scooch over a bit. Okay, so next up we're going to do a really beautiful song. Now, if anyone found that difficult, and it is difficult, but you could get it with a bit of practice, right? This one is a lot simpler. The chords have got fancy pants names, so they sound difficult, but they're really not in this one. They're really relatively simple, and they sound really, really beautiful as well. So this is kind of early mid part of Pet Sounds, and we go into these really beautiful melancholic love songs, which are really gorgeous. And I love the fact that Brian Wilson does a lot of the singing on this. He recorded a lot of his vocals on his own and then recorded the Beach Boys as a group afterwards, adding their beautiful vocal harmonies, which is really lovely. Incidentally, he worked with some of the best kind of musicians in the country on this one. So he used a band called the Wrecking Crew. I don't know if you guys have heard of them. People like Carol Kay, even Glenn Campbell was a member of the Wrecking Crew at some point. Hal Blaine on drums. Some really brilliant musicians that used to basically, they were they're almost like a touring band of session musicians that used to help out on various albums. And so many albums of the 1960s, it's not actually the bands playing, it's the Wrecking Crew playing on them. They were amazing players. In fact, one of the Wrecking Crew on double bass was a guy called Lyle Ritz, who some of you guys will know from ukulele. He had a brilliant ukulele album called How About Uke? And 50 of State Uke. So he played a little bit of ukulele, but mostly double bass on the album. But there is ukulele on Pet Sounds. A lot of people don't realise. Anyway, onwards and upwards. Let's have a look at this one. This one's in the key of G. So we're going to count up the chords from G this time. So G is 1, A minor 2, B minor 3, C 4, D 5, E minor 6, and then F sharp diminished, but I don't think we use it, so don't worry about it, as number 7. And remember earlier I mentioned those 2-5-1 progressions. You can see them all over here. It starts with a 1, but if you ignore that G, after that we've got A minor 7, D 7, G, A minor 7, D 7, G. It's just 2-5-1s, the most common chord progression in all of jazz. But Brian Wilson decides to start with the 1 chord. Now, in terms of playing them, they're really nice and simple. So the G major chord, you all know G, easy peasy lemon squeezy, right? Then the A minor, we do that for a whole measure. Now this, the last one, I didn't give you strum pattern because it's just simple up and down, right? This one we're going to do straight eights. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. So basically we're going to do all down strums using the nails of this hand, like this, because this one has quite a straight rhythm, not so swung as the last one that we did. Okay, so we're going to do a measure of G like this. So 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Then we're going to take our fingers off for A minor 7. We're going to put them onto a Hawaiian D7. You could do this one, but I find Hawaiian easier. And then we go back to G. Okay? It'll sound something like this. Oh, actually, we're going to change a bit quicker than that. So it'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. All right, so straight fours, if you like. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. And we just keep that going round. That's all there is to the verse, over and over. Practice with me. G, off D7, G, off D7, G, off D7, G. Lovely. Now if you want, you can hit some up strums to thicken it up a bit. Hands already coming up for your down strums, but if in doubt, if that throws you off your rhythm, just keep coming down. That'll sound something like this. Oh, just let me just move my lyric sheet. Sorry, guys, staring at my double chin for a minute. There we go. It'll sound something like this. 1 and 2.
I know perfectly well I'm not where I should be.
So straightforward, right? Then he goes to the 4 chord, and I don't know what it is about this 4 chord, the way it pairs with the melodic notes that he chooses, it just gets me in the heartstrings. It's really, really beautiful. So we go to C for a whole measure, every time, to the 5 chord. Now this bit, I'm calling that the 5 chord after C, but really it's the 1 chord, isn't it, played as a dominant 7th. But notice that it pairs up with the C. If you think of C as the 1, G7 would be the 5, but I've kept them the same numbers. But C, G7, C. Then we go to the 5 chord, D7. And then an E7. And you might think, well, an E7 doesn't belong in the key, and you'd be right. The E7 is what we call a secondary dominant chord. We've nicked the 5 chord from the key of A. In the key of G, remember the 6 chord should be a minor. Don't worry if that goes over your head and you're not sure what that means, but regular Kanikapilas will know G, A, B, C, D. The 6 chord is normally a minor, but we're playing it as a 7th. So it's like we've stolen it from the key of A. The reason he uses it is the next chord is an A minor. And that E7 loves to resolve down to an A. Really, it wants to go to an A major. But it goes to an A minor for some melancholy, which is really lovely. Yeah, I think Indrani, yeah, you're dead right. I think it should say chorus on this bit, really. Yeah, it's probably just my scribbles when I sent him to Asteroid, but first when I meant chorus. Yeah, well spotted. But this bit I'd call the chorus, or the bridge. Sometimes it's called the bridge. All right, let's just try the first bit of that bridge so you can see it, the C to G7.
Every time we break up, you bring back your love to me.
Isn't that lovely? Then a beautiful A minor.
After all I've done to you.
Finger off for A minor 7, just adds a bit of richness.
How can it be?
Now the beautiful payoff line, E minor 7. That is quite a natural chord in the key of G, an E minor. Only instead of doing it like this, we turn it into an E minor 7, which kind of looks like a G without this finger. I like to play it that way. You can do it like this, however you like.
You still...
B minor 7, we used it in the last song, just bar the second fret. And then we finish it with this minor 7 flat 5. Brian Wilson loved to finish with a minor 7 flat 5. It's a half diminished chord, is another way of saying that, an A half diminished. Now that's a jazz musician's trick. Quite often, rather than using the 5 chord to create tension, they use the 2 chord played as a half diminished. You just have to remember that. Don't worry too much about it. But it's a real jazzers thing to do. And Brian Wilson does it at the end of this verse, end of this chorus in this song. But he also does it at the start of the next song as well. So you'll hear it as well. All right. So let's try that chorus bit really, really slowly from the top. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, see.
Every time we break up, you bring back your love to me. And after all I've done to you, how can it be?
I tend to do that A minor 7 flat 5 like this, use my third and first. But if you want, you can do the water full of fingers version like this. Or you can even do 1 and 2. Remember, you're only touching that G string up there. You don't have to throttle that second fret. Just get it on that top string. That's why I find it a bit more comfortable like that. I can double bar, look here. Okay. And then we just go round for another verse. Again, isn't it really beautiful? Such beautiful chords. Then basically, in terms of the structure of this one, we just do that twice. So we do verse, chorus, and then the outro is just another verse, but we just sing this I Wanna Cry, and it's really kind of heartbreaking, especially when Brian Wilson sings it and he's not shattering glass like I do when I sing it, because I can't quite reach the note, but it sounds really beautiful. So that last, the second time you come out of this this verse here, where is it? There. We hit that A minor 7 flat 5.
I wanna cry.
And if you know the harmonies on that bit, you can sing along to me if you know the song. It just goes lower and higher. And there's a false stop as well. So if I stop and then you think the song's over, hang in there because it starts up again on that G, A minor, D7 bit, round and round. You'll get the idea, I reckon. You'll be absolutely fine. Let's really enjoy it. It's such a beautiful song. Some really beautiful, sophisticated chords. Let's give it a go. Okay, so... here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's just do a few of these instruments now. Just to get us going. Here we go.
I know perfectly well I'm not where I should be. Back your love to me. sometimes I found myself. And after all I've promised you so faithfully,
Did I get anyone with the false ending? I think in the original it's a beautiful bass note from Carol Kay. Dum, 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 like a heartbeat. And then it starts up again with the lovely ah. Now, one man in England with his ukulele sat in a kind of a dark and dusky room at night, with not the best singing voice, doesn't really do these songs justice, but I really hope you're getting a sense of those beautiful, beautiful chords. If all you do is just play them through one at a time, just really mellow, just really appreciate how gorgeous those are, especially that last bit, that lovely. Isn't that gorgeous? So really worth kind of taking your time with and take it, learning those. So yeah. No worries, Karen. I hope you're lucky. Really hope you get to see it and you have a nice clear day. So yeah. Oh, it's beautiful, beautiful song, this, Indrani. If you haven't listened to Pet Sounds before, it's so worth checking out. It's just so beautiful. And Brian Wilson was doing things that other musicians just weren't doing. So Pet Sounds really went on to influence the Beatles, for instance. So the Beatles wrote Rubber Soul and then Revolver. And that kind of, that lit something in Brian Wilson's mind. He talks about Rubber Soul and how it feels like a folk album. And he wanted to write an album, not of hits, but of just really beautiful love songs, which he did. And then this one went on to influence the kind of the beautiful sophistication of it, went on to influence the Beatles, who then did Sgt. Pepper afterwards. And there was a lot of this kind of to and fro with the Beatles and Beach Boys, really interesting. Paul McCartney talks about meeting up Brian Wilson and being quite influenced. And if you listen to the record, it's not just the chords are stunning, but the vocal harmonies are obviously sophisticated as well. But you have these layers of textures that it doesn't sound like normal pop music. There's not these block chords on guitar. You know, you've got this double bass and you've got xylophone and you've got these bass clarinets, all sorts of interesting things going on. So if you haven't already done it, really have a listen to the whole of Pet Sounds and it's beautiful. It was recorded in mono because Brian Wilson had an ear problem. It probably went back to when his dad hit him when he was a kid. He was beaten as a kid. His dad was very controlling and abusive. And he hit him as a kid, and Brian Wilson thinks that might be why he went deaf in one ear. So again, amazing that he could write all these textures and things, and he heard in mono rather than stereo, which is kind of interesting. Okay, just before we do the next couple of songs, just a couple of things I wanted to let you know about. So my next live lesson is coming up, not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday. And in this one, we're going to learn, we're going to have a look at how to learn ukulele arrangements. Now, what do I mean by that? How we learn ukulele arrangements? Well, have you ever been presented with a piece of music and it's in tablature form or sheet music and it's just completely kind of overwhelming and you don't know where to start? Well, I'm going to break down how to take an arrangement and how to work on it. Really work on specific things like which fingers are the best to use in a particular part, both with your fretted hand and your picking hand as well. Thinking about, is it best to use pima style, where we associate a finger with a string, or is it best to use your thumb for everything, or a mixture? We'll have a look at that as well. I'll help you to read tablature. We'll talk about things like hammer-ons and pull-offs and slides. We'll talk about musical directions. So like when you get a DC, if you ever get like a DC out cap, what am I thinking? Yeah, DC out. I've forgotten. I'm having a completely daft. What's the word for a coda? DC Alcoda. So, which would be da capo, back to the start, and then to the coda. I couldn't think of a word for coda. It just completely went out of my brain. Things like that, second and first repeats, all those kind of interesting things. And then, well, if we've got time, I really want to talk to you about how to practice as well. So maybe about concentrating on the most difficult sections first, rather than playing the easier parts again and again, which we're all guilty of, right? Because it's enjoyable playing the easy parts. But sometimes tackling that those toughest parts first, things like that. So I give you lots of tips. So it's going to be, I'm really excited about this one. The sheets to this are epic because I took lots of actual arrangements and little snippets of them. And I've put loads of examples so we can do, rather than one song, we can look at lots of different pieces of arrangements to give you some ideas. So I'm quite passionate about this one. I've really got into these live lessons this season, you've probably noticed. So this is really excited about this. So a week Wednesday, 3:30 UK time. You can watch them back whenever you want, and they're available on my website, mattsteadukulele.com, after they've been recorded. If you sign up as a member to my website, as well as the 9 courses and all the other gubbins you get the worksheets for free at no extra cost. Obviously you're paying your subscription, but you get your sheets included in that. And they normally cost £5 or £8. So that's almost like monthly subscription just in itself, just from that. Okay, anyway, enough of that. Let's get back to Pet Sounds. Now we've got one more Pet Sounds song, which is really, really beautiful and gorgeous, I think. Then we're going to do a song by U2. Now, if these chords have been a bit much for anyone, the last song, stick around for it, because the chords are C, A minor, F and G. All right, that's it. And they literally just same chords over and over. So stick around, one more song with hard chords, and then it gets a lot easier. So yeah, thank you. Yeah, thanks, Harry. Sometimes I've had a really testing day, and sometimes like my brain just goes kaput. It drives me mad. I do it at home sometimes when I've had a really long day. I go home and I'll say to Sharon, oh, can you pass me the, and I won't be able to think of a word for, say, scissors. I'll be like, can you pass me the cutty things? It just goes. So, it's been a testing day. If you weren't here at the start, my car broke down. My coffee pot smashed, so I haven't had coffee all day. And my upstairs neighbours in the workshop have been making loads of noise. So it's been a testing day. But I've enjoyed Kanikapila. It's worth getting through it to be here with you lot. Okay, let's have a look at Caroline now. Now, this song was the last song on Pet Sounds, and it's really quite simple, but absolutely beautiful. Again, really unusual chords in the fact that we've got 6 chords rather than major chords. Okay, so really, really beautiful. So, oh, cool. Oh, I like that. Nice. Cool, that's really good. I love it, Stefan, when people play ukulele and they all do different parts, because we can be guilty at clubs, can't we, of like everyone plays the same part strumming along. So nice to break it up like that. I'm writing some duets and quartets at the moment for the ukulele grades, and it's so nice when you hear all those little bits come together. It's really satisfying. I think they call it like the parts are greater than the sum of the whole is greater than the sum of the parts, isn't it? Just sounds great when we do that. Okay, so, sorry guys, my voice is good. Let's have a look at this Caroline now then. So this one is in the key of D. lots of different keys tonight. So D is going to be our one chord. And rather than playing a normal D, which looks like this, we're going to play a D6. You can do four fingers in a row like this. Or I think the easiest way is just a bar the whole of that second fret like that. So what is a D6? If you're interested, I won't bore you with too much theory, but a D6 is a major triad, normal D chord, which is D, what we've got, F sharp and A. And then we also take the sixth note of D. So we just go D, E, F, G, A, and that's a B. And if you think about it, that makes sense because that note is a B. And we're taking a D major triad and we're adding B. Okay, so D6 is just literally a D chord with the sixth note of D added, which is B, like that. Okay, so we still call it a major chord, but it's a major six, and we just shorten that to D6. Yeah, it's been a real challenge, Esther, but really fun. Really, really fun. Yeah, that's it. That's it, Indrani. A D6 is exactly the same as the B7 we did earlier. They're enharmonic equivalents. So it depends what key you're in, which one we call it, basically. Same as this is an A7 and a C6. This is a B7 and a D6. If we went two higher, we'd have a C sharp minor 7 and an E6. And in fact, that's the first chord. We start with the two chord played as a major six. And then we just drop back to the one chord. Isn't that lovely? So it's almost like rather than having the five chord for the tension, we've got the two chord for kind of melancholy. And then we've got that lovely one chord. So you can just take that bar up and down for the start of this song. And then we get this beautiful heartbreaking chord, the two chord played as a minor seven. So instead of the E being a minor, it was a six. Now it's a minor seven. In jazz music, you way more often get an E7 than you do a standard E minor. It's more sophisticated and richer sounding. That goes to an A7, which is the sixth chord, and then we finish that with a D7, like this. I've just realised another mistake. This is my bad. There's a mistake in the sheets. I wonder, Esther, when you're back into it, I might get you to correct this. That's my bad. That A7 there should say the 5, not the 6, because it's the 5th, isn't it, in the key of D. That's just me being daft. Because that E7, A7 is a 2, 5, 1. Again, another 2, 5, 1. All right, let me just go through that slowly then. E6, 2, 3, 4, D6, E6, D6, one more E6, then E7, just for two now, A7, and then a D7. Just so beautiful. Isn't that gorgeous? Let me sing it over the top. I can't sing it like Brian Wilson, but even hopefully with my bad singing, you'll hear how beautiful this is. I think it's a gorgeous song. It goes something like this. Where did your long hair go? Where is the girl I used to know? How could you lose that happy glow? Oh, Carolina. Let me just go again. Who took that look away? I remember how you used to say you'd never change, but that's not true. And then that takes you into this, oh my gosh, this is my favourite bit of tonight. The bridge is just so gorgeous. Again, Brian Wilson being Brian Wilson does something really unusual. The bridge is in the key of A. So he's gone to like the five, but as a key change, really unusual. So the whole of this next section is in the key of A. It's really, really beautiful. We've still got a 2-5-1 look, this B minor 7, E 7, A major 7, but we're in the key of A. So that chord that was a D6 is now a B minor 7. Because we're in the key of A, it's acting as the 2 chord. 2-5-1. A major 7 looks like this. You know how you can play an A like this? We take this one here. So A major 7 here. All right. 1-1-0-0. So that bit. 1-2-1-2-1-2-3-4. Mike, let me just go over the count in a second. All right. So that's just a, don't worry, Esther, I didn't spot it, and I went through them again, so it's so hard to spot these things. I proofread things a million times when I do like my sheets for Wednesdays, but there's always the odd thing. It's impossible to get everything perfect, I think. Let me just go through that timing, Mike, for you. So it's 4 each, and I'm just doing those straight 8 down strums. That just means all down strums. 1-2-3-4. Then on the second line of the verse, 4 E6s, 1-2-3-4. 2 E minor 7s, 1-2. 2 A 7s, 1-2. And then 8 D major 7s, 1-2-3-4. 5-6-7-8. All right. Yeah, cool. All right, so let's get back to this bridge then. We're starting with 2 beats of that B minor 7, E7, and then just pull back this finger. I just love that. Then we've got a mini 2-5-1 in the key of F sharp minor. This is where the chords get a little bit crazy, but they're not too bad. The first one, this G sharp minor 7 flat 5, which is hard enough to say, right? I think of it as, you can kind of think of it as a half diminished chord is another way to say it. It's just like that A minor 7 flat 5 we were doing earlier, right? Actually, it should have been there. But we're back at the first fret. And then, and you can do that as waterfall of fingers like this. And then we go to this diminished chord. Think of it like a G7 with this finger up here. Last 3 fingers of a G7. And then F sharp minor. You can either move those 3 up or just switch out. Okay, I do that really slowly. It'll look like this. 1-2-1-2-1-2-3. Let me do the whole of that line in slow motion from the B minor 7. 1-2-1-2-1-2-3-4. Yeah, that's it. And then, yeah, like Stefan said, that's another way of counting it. I'm almost doing that there. You got it. And then we go up to the B minor 7 flat 5, B half diminished. Same shape we're doing for this one, the G sharp, but we're right up at this 4th and 5th. Again, you can do waterfall of fingers, I call it, or you can do your 2-finger one. And Brian Wilson, like I say, loves to end sections with a half diminished chord. Sounds really beautiful. Okay, so that bit we would go... really want to go cry. It's so sad to watch a sweet thing die. Oh, Caroline, why? Now we're back to our absolutely gorgeous. What I'll do, let me just do a verse and a chorus just so you get a feel of how it works, and then we'll go back and do the whole song. All right, so verse from here, 2, 3, 4. Where did your long hair go? Where is the girl I used to know? To the end, basically, and just keep going. All right, let's give it a try. Let's see if we can do this from the top. Again, just if you find it difficult to strum in time with this, because those chords are quite tricky, aren't they? Maybe just strum once per chord. 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4. I'll take the rhythm, particularly when you get to that bridge bit. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 2. See how that gives you time to change your fingers, which is lovely. Yeah, exactly, Karen. Me too. Let me just see if I can bring Karen's coming up. Yeah, that chorus. Isn't that gorgeous? That's why I love, don't be scared by some of these scary chord names, because they sound so beautiful when you get them. Really worth sticking with. And if you don't get this straight away, you can always come back and practice this. You can download the sheets. They're completely free to download and print off, and then you can take your own time with it. And of course, a lot of my students, you'll notice we've got a website, as well as mattsteadukulele.com. You can post in the forum there. If you visit my Facebook page, Uke Students Hangout, you can post videos of you having a go at this stuff, and we give all help each other and encourage each other along. So another good thing to do. Okay, let's try this one from the top, and then we'll do something easy to finish off. Here we go. 1, 2. I'm gonna get my finger there ready. 1, 2, 3, 4. Where did your long hair go? Where is the girl I used to know? How could you lose that happy glow? Oh, Carolina. And again. Who took that look away? I remember how you used to say you'd never change, but that's not true. Oh, Caroline, you break my heart. I really wanna go and cry. It's so sad to watch a sweet thing die. Oh, Caroline. Love you so much then.
starting chord spell.
Isn't that a gorgeous song? So the original, that outro just plays round and round and it just gradually kind of fades out. And it's lovely. The kind of name Pet Sounds comes from Brian Wilson used to wonder if dogs could pick up on vibrations, you know, like happy or angry vibrations and stuff. It also influences on Good Vibrations, obviously. So he called this album Pet Sounds. And if you listen really carefully to the end of the song, you'll hear a train go by. And then you'll hear two dogs barking. And that was his own dogs, Banana and Louie. And when my first, my second band actually, when my second band split up in London and me and Sharon started singing as a duet, we called ourselves Banana and Louie after Brian Wilson's two dogs. So, it's such a, I just thought that was such a cool name for two dogs. I'm going to nick it as a band name. Yeah, I know what you mean, slopey. It's like they kind of slide into each other, don't they, Indrani? Yeah, totally. A really good thing I'm thinking about, yeah. Our eclipse is just starting. Don't worry, if anyone wants to go and see the eclipse rather than the last song, I'm not offended at all. You can always come back to this later on. I think our numbers are a bit lower because I think everyone's out with their special specs, aren't they, in America? So, yeah. Apparently, you can just see a little nibble of the sun if you go out in the very west of Cornwall, but I'm not quite far enough west, apparently. I did check. Okay, right, let's have a look at our last song. Now, this is a really, really simple song, but really, really beautiful. We're going to have a look at With or Without You by U2. And I'm going to show you how to do a picking pattern on this one as well, because it's so simple and beautiful. This song was our people's choice. So every week, Karen runs a Facebook poll. And on that poll, we have four or five songs from the vaults. So we've been doing Kanikapila for a couple of years now, and we've covered literally hundreds of songs. So Karen picks some of our favourite songs, and she gets you guys to pick which you want to do as a people's choice. And this week, you guys picked With or Without You by U2, which is an absolutely great song and really, really simple. So this song uses one of the most common chord progressions in all of Western music. That's the one chord, followed by the five chord, which creates a little bit of tension, followed by the six chord, which is all about melancholy. And then the four chord gives that melancholy a little lift. In fact, that A minor to F is what Leonard Cohen, as we looked at last week in the live lesson, called the minor fall and the major lift. Minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king opposing, hallelujah. So that's what we've got going on there. And there's so many songs. I won't hesitate no more, no more, it cannot wait. I'm yours. Trying to think of others. I'm going under, and this time I fear there's no one to save me. Liz Capaldi. There's literally hundreds and hundreds of songs using this chord progression. It all goes back to George Gershwin, who played it as C, A minor 7, D minor 7 instead of F, G 7. I got river. And then doo-woppers changed that to D minor, blue moon. I saw you standing alone. And then pop artists took the D minor and changed it to an F because it's only one note different. I'd like to be under the sea in an octopus's garden in the shade. And then modern artists swap the chords around so we get C, G, A minor, F. So there we go. Just one of the most common chord progressions of all time. And this song just goes round and round with that chord progression. Now, if you want to strum this one, we're going to do a very guitar-like straight eight strum. So I like to use three nails coming down, but I concentrate my strum on the top three strings. Sometimes I'll hit the A string, but I concentrate it just on those top few, keeping it light. Now the count is one and two and three and four and down, 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 one and two and three and four and. So if you're strumming it, we would strum C, G, A minor, F. We would just keep that going round. Straight eight strum is if you want to thicken it up, you can just touch on the way up as well. Now, as I say, you're not as we did in the earlier songs. If you want to do that, you're not adding, you're not kind of adding an extra movement because your hand's already going down and up, even though it's only hitting downs. So all you need to do at any point is touch on the up. Notice my hand's not moving any quicker, but you're hearing twice as many notes because I'm just touching on the way up. And I do that when I want to start beefing it up a bit. With or without you, with or without you. See, I've just thickened it up, and that's another thing you can do. The other thing that you can do on this one is this lovely inside-out picking pattern. I use my thumb on the C string, index finger on E, thumb on G, index finger on A. I call it inside-outside, inside-outside, inside-outside. Notice how my fingers just cycle through. You would do that twice on every chord like this. Allow yourself to go wrong. What you don't want to do is this, because then you've lost the song. Just keep picking no matter what, even if you go wrong like this. Even if you're not there in time, just keep that right hand going. And you get this lovely. Through the storm, we reach the shore. Give it all, but I want more. And I'm waiting for you. And I'm going to do that all the way through the first two verses and choruses, and then I'm going to start strumming to build up that kind of, that really nice kind of gradual build in this song, which is really lovely. That's what it's all about. It's what so many U2 songs are about. They do so well, is that kind of gradual build, and this is probably the best example. There we go. Okay, so let's give that a go from the top. If in doubt, just keep strumming C, G, A minor and F and really enjoy it. And we're going to build up and we're going to get crazier and crazier. And at the end, we're going to really let rip. All right, here we go. Last song for tonight. Thank you, everyone, for joining in. I've really, really appreciated it. I've had a rubbish day, as I say, but this has made me feel a lot better. I'm ready for my birthday now. I could go into it smiling rather than being like, So it's all good. Thank you. You guys always give me a massive lift every Monday. Honestly, I do a 12-hour day on Monday and you think I'd be like exhausted and fed up, and I go home with the biggest smile on my face because I love doing this with you guys, and hopefully some of you guys enjoy it too. Here we go then from the top. I'll come in on close cam. Here we go. One, two, three, four. See the stone set in your eyes. see the thorn twist in your side. I'll wait for you. Sleight of hand and twist of fate, on a bed of nails she makes me wait. And I wait without you. With or without you. With or without you. Through the storm we reach the shore. You give it all, but I want more. I'm waiting for you. With or without you. With or without you. I can't live with or without you. And you give yourself away. Yourself away, and you give yourself away. My hands are tied, my body bruised. She got me with nothing to win, and nothing to lose. With or without you, I can't live. With or without you,
let's do that chorus.
With or without you, with or without you, I can't live.
Well done, everyone. A little bit easier, that one, right?
But still really effective. Just goes to show that sometimes you don't need a million chords for a song to sound absolutely beautiful. There's kind of ways and means, isn't there, for everything. And that one sounds great just with four chords. It sounds absolutely brilliant. Now, I've got an apology to make. I completely forgot to give you your solo possibilities on that one. So I might do that one more time just to finish off quickly, so you can have a go at soloing. If you want to try soloing on this one, where we do the ho-oh-oh-oh bits, you can just hit your A minor pentatonic scale. So that's off 3, 5, 7, 10. And 12. So basically that's all the dots on your uke. Open string, third, fifth, seventh, 10, 12. You can also do all your dots in the E string. Only remember, we have to hit the 8th fret, so not that one. We have to go up to 8. That's the only exception. You can hit all your other dots on that string. You can also play open C and a D, E and G, and A and G. So if you want, you can have a little play. We'll do it one more time, and you can just have a little go. Now, I don't know which is out of tune. It's either my ukulele earlier or now. So one of us is out of tune. So that's not the best example, but gives you an idea. You can have a little go at a solo. Now, generally we do, generally we do a lot more soloing in Kanikapila, but this week the chords were so sophisticated in the Pet Sounds songs, I thought it was best to just keep them as they were. But let's just finish. We'll do that with or without you one more time. Just so you can have a go at a little bit of soloing. Okay, and then we'll go leave it from there. So take care, everyone. We'll do one last song. Thanks, guys. Thank you. I don't think you guys even need the sheets for this one, do you? Just C, G, A minor and F over and over. You'll get this. So, yeah. Oh, the eclipse didn't go. Ah, that's a shame. Never mind. All right. Thanks, guys. Thank you. All right, there's one more go at this one. And then I'll stick around just see if there's any questions. And then we'll go from there. Here we go. G, A minor F. Just keep that going. C, G, A minor F.
See the stone set in your eyes. See the thorn twist in your side. I'll wait for you.
I like this song anyway.
Sleight of hand and twist of fate. On a bed of nails she makes me wait. And I'll wait without you. With or without you. With or without you. The storm, we reach the shore. You give it all, but I want more. And I'm waiting for you. With or without you. With or without you.
pardon, everyone. That's such a fun song to play, isn't it? I love the simple ones sometimes. I love the ones with the kind of the lovely, gorgeous kind of chords, but sometimes it's just nice to do that as well. So, yeah, absolutely brilliant. Oh, thanks, Jonathan. I hope you're doing well, mate. We'll have to have a catch-up soon. It'd be lovely to have a cup of coffee, see how you're getting on, guys. So, brilliant. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Fantastic. So, yeah, I get the metronome idea from Stefan's a good idea with that, Rebecca. Sometimes just kind of really tapping your foot will help as well in terms of counting. So it's a bit more forgiving than a metronome, because then if you do speed up a little bit, you can bring yourself back. So kind of... Can you hear that? I'm counting on basically every other beat. One, two, one. I guess it's 1 and 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Just to kind of keep yourself in time. It is easy to speed up. We all do it. So, yeah, cool. Ah, thanks, guys. Lots of fun. Brilliant. So just a reminder, guys, we're off next week, but hopefully, oh my gosh, please keep your fingers crossed for me. Hopefully it's for good cause. Next week, GigaClear are meant to be coming in and putting my fibre broadband in. Now, if it works, and it happens next Monday, those of you that have seen my live lessons like last week where I do them at home with my super fast broadband, I've got GigaClear at home. It's a lot more seamless. There's no buffering. The picture quality is better. The sound quality is better. So fingers crossed, next Monday we'll be away. But the Monday we get back after that, I should have my super fast in. So that will be brilliant. It'll make such a difference. So off next Monday, but back the Monday after that. And after that, we go for a little while, just every week then. So we shall get back to it. So yeah. Fantastic. Ah, cool. Yeah, I like that. Nice. Cool. All right, guys, I'll just stick around and see if there's any questions just for a minute. Just a reminder that, as I say, keep an eye out for my new course that's going to start. I'll be editing the video. It will either be up late this week or start of next week. And that's going to be Dr. Jazz, the very first one from this course. And this is going to be a subscription course. So all of you gold members will get this for free. Oh, it's my iPad's making noise. Let me just switch it off. Okay. There we go. That should help. So that one, subscribers will get as part of their package, as well as the fingerstyle course and all the other ones. Anyone that's doing the baritone course, I haven't forgotten about you, so there'll be another baritone video as well coming later this week. So we're going to do our first fingerstyle baritone arrangement, which I'm really excited about. We're going to look at Cywaltz, which is one of my original pieces, and I'm really, really looking forward to that. So that'd be great. So thanks, guys. Thank you. Yay! Ah, oh, thanks, John. That was brilliant. That would really cheer me up. That'd be amazing. I'd love that. Fantastic. Oh, thanks, Rebecca. That's good to hear. I hope I didn't scare too many people off with the scary chords, but we'll kind of mix and match, so they won't all be this hard. So yeah. Oh, I'm so sorry about the eclipse, guys. It's been such a big deal, hasn't it, for so long. It's such a disappointment when you can't see it after all that kind of excitement. I'm really sad for you guys, because I know you guys have been planning it quite a lot, haven't you, those in the States and Canada. But hopefully you had a bit of fun here instead. So like you say, dampens the disappointment, which is good. And as Karen says, thanks, Karen. Live lesson next week as well, which I'm really excited about. This one's going to really be in a lot of depth, how to learn ukulele arrangements. That's going to be next Wednesday at 3:30 as well. And I will see you guys there. Well, take care, everyone. Thanks for bearing with me today. You've really cheered me up and you've really kind of seen me through. So much, much appreciated. Sending all my love. And I will be back 2 weeks on Monday for the next Kanikapila and a week Wednesday for the next live lesson. Take care and see you soon, everyone.